Good evening, everyone. We'll be beginning
good evening
by a word of prayer by our resource person, Reverend Father Dr. Joji C. George.
Let's pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts and sins, as we also have forgiven our debtors. Lead us not to temptation, deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you so much, Acha. Once again, good evening, everyone. It gives me so much joy to welcome you all to another episode of the Dr. Paulo Smar Gregorio Study Series. This month is even more special because it celebrates the 25th death anniversary of our beloved late His Grace Dr. Paulo Smar Gregorio Tirumeni. As you all know, we've been having these sessions since a long time, and we've been discussing another interesting fact about Tirumeni is that he was a founder of the Delhi Orthodox Center. He was an ecumenical leader for interfaith dialogue and also the president of WCC, a lifelong seeker of knowledge and truth. All of us feel so proud to be part of a church which gave birth to one of the greatest theologians in the world, Dr. Paulo Smar Gregorius. On behalf of MJOSM Delhi Diocese, I take this opportunity to welcome our esteemed resource person for the evening, Reverend Father Dr. Joji C. George. It's an honor to have our resource person with us for the evening. And along with that, I also extend a hearty welcome to all the panelists who are here. Ms. Rini Vergis from Mar Gregorius Orthodox Church, Janakpuri. Mr. Abel John Panikkar from St. Gregorius Orthodox Church, Jebel Ali. And Ms. Ginny Jacob from St. Mary's Orthodox Church, Faridabad. Along with the panelists, we are also having something new today. We have all the study secretaries from across the diocese, and we also have all the central committee members over here of Delhi Diocese. They have also joined the Zoom meeting, and they are present with us in the meeting. And I, Feba Mariam Panikkar, along with Ms. Ananya Elizabeth Vergis, will be the moderators for the evening. The theme for today's episode is Kingdom of Diaconia. We've shared the article already. I'm sure you all must have at least gone through the article. Tirumeni, in his writing in the article, he very beautifully shares his understanding about the importance of taking acceptance and rejection, approval and disapproval, with the same equanimity and rejoicing. Tirumeni also emphasizes about the rich idea of royal priesthood, which includes the priestly task of interceding and sacrificing for others, and the kingly task of laying down one's life for others. So the link for the article, as I've already mentioned, is in the description box for the YouTube link that you all been using to view this program. So without wasting any more time, I would invite our resource person, Reverend Father Dr. Joji C. George, New Testament Professor at St. Thomas Orthodox Theological Seminary, Nagpur, to take over the session and introduce us to our theme for the day. Thank you, Acha.
Reverend Father Cherian Joseph, Vice President, MGOCSM Delhi, I think Achan will join soon. Ananya and Feba, moderators of this program. Panel members Renil, Abel, and Ginny, and all other members of MGOCSM, and all those who are viewing this program, good evening and greetings to you all in the name of the Triune God. I'm very happy and honored to be a part of this study series. As a seminary student, I didn't actually get an opportunity to learn directly from Paulo Smar Gregorius, the great theologian, thinker, and philosopher of our church. Tirumeni passed away in 1996, and we joined the seminary in 1997. During my seminary days, I read only very few books of Thirumeni. His spiritual autobiography, you all know that book, Love's Freedom, A Grand Mystery. And also his biography written by Joyce Thottakkad, which is a Malayalam book, Prakashathileke. These were the only two books which I read about Thirumeni. Apart from that, I did not even dare to open any of the books written by Thirumeni, because there was a myth among the students that Paulus Mar Gregorius is difficult to understand. So many of us were very much afraid to read anything which is written by Thirumeni. It was only in 2015 when I came back to India after my studies, I got an unexpected assignment from my guru, Father K.M. George, a distinguished disciple of Paulus Mar Gregorius, to assist him in completing a book on Thirumeni, which will serve as a reference book for all his writings. Maybe you all might have seen that today, yesterday, seminary has released the Indian edition of that book, Paulus Mar Gregorius, A Reader. That was actually a difficult task, and I was asked to read about 23 books, important works of Paulus Mar Gregorius, and to choose some self-contained passages which would be a pointer to his thoughts. By assisting Father K.M. George in completing this book, I learned a lot about the thoughts of Paulus Mar Gregorius, but still, I should confess, there's still a long way to go. Now, you may wonder why I'm narrating all these stories. Well, this is an anticipatory bail. I'm still trying to learn and understand the thoughts of Thirumeni, and let's learn together. The today's topic which we have selected are not actually articles. They are two biblical Bible meditations delivered by Thirumeni at the WCC. And we all know, as you all know, it was through the Bible studies Metropolitan Paulus Mar Gregorius became most popular. He showed his interest in interpreting the Bible even while he was teaching in Ethiopia as a layman. And later on, when he joined the WCC, he was well appreciated for his novelty and depth of his biblical meditations. The present topic is from a series of biblical meditations delivered by Thirumeni at the WCC, which was later published by them as a small book named The Meaning and Nature of Diaconia. And later on, these meditations were combined with some other biblical meditations of Thirumeni, and Mar Gregorius Foundation republished it in the name Kingdom of Diaconia. And there I got this name, Kingdom of Diaconia, for this lecture. The meditations which we are discussing today are the fourth and the fifth among the five meditation series on the topic of diaconia. The first two meditations are word studies. We have not selected those topics, but it is good to have a bird's eye view of what Thirumeni is saying in those two meditations. Those two meditations serves as a background to the following three meditations. In the first two introductory meditations, Thirumeni is explaining the different shades of meaning of the word diaconia. As you all know, diaconia is a Greek word which means service. And we all know that the word deacon or diakonos, which means servant, comes from the same root. To get into the real background of the New Testament use of this word, Thirumeni makes a beautiful study of the corresponding Hebrew word, abodha, which is used in the Old Testament. The Hebrew word abodha means simply work or any kind of service or a cultic service. In the book of Exodus, chapter 7, verse 16, Yahweh commands Moses to say to Pharaoh, "Commission my people so that they may offer abodha or worship to me, worship to me." And this word is used repeatedly in the book of Exodus, and many many times in the other books of the Torah. This is the original vocation of the people of Israel, to be a worship offering people. So the word diakonia means service, and the Hebrew word for diakonia is aboda. And aboda has two different meanings, basically has two different meanings. One is normal work or service, and the other one is cultic service, that means worship. So Yahweh is asking Moses to say to Pharaoh that to release my people so that they may offer aboda to me, so that they may offer worship to me. So this is the original vocation of the people of Israel, to be a worship offering people. Sabbath, we all know, which is the seventh day, the day of rest, it was separated for the aboda Yahweh. That means ceasing from the ordinary work or the ordinary aboda or service in order to devote themselves entirely to the Lord's aboda or worship. Here, Thirumeni criticizes his Western audience that the Reformation churches is completely blind to this aboda Yahweh aspect of the Old Testament because of the anti-clericalism and anti-ritualism, which was a product of Reformation and Western Enlightenment. The aboda or diakonia cannot be limited to preaching the word or doing social service. The Eucharist is the church's diakonia par excellence, which empowers and qualifies us to speak and act. This is the first and the basic understanding of diakonia. That is, diakonia is not just a service or social action, but it is first and foremost the aboda Yahweh or worship offering to God. The second important aspect of diakonia or aboda is the dialectic or dialogic relation between aboda Yahweh and aboda to the fellow human beings. Isaiah 57, chapter 57, verse 15 says, I dwell in high and holy, and also in one who is bruised and lowly, to lift up the heart of the bruised. This is God's natural habitat, which is dialectical. On the one hand, God is in his inaccessible heights of holiness beyond time and space. But on the other hand, he is among the bruised and the brokenhearted, among the needy and the oppressed. This is God's dialectic dwelling. Therefore, the call of the church is for this double diakonia. That means the diakonia of service of God in worship on behalf of the people of the world, and the diakonia of the fellow human beings in the name of God. So it is in this background, the first meditation that we are discussing today is explained. It is about the priestly character of the call of Israel. Israel was chosen from a community of nations to be the priest of that community of nations, to be the light of the nations, to stand on behalf of the nations before God as their priest. Therefore, the aim of the church is not its personal salvation, but the salvation as a priestly kingdom whose main task is to pray and intercede for nations and peoples. With this in mind, let us discuss the final meditation, which explains Christ's ministry to the world. The three aspects of Jesus' ministry are the priestly, the prophetic, and the king shepherd ministry. The first one, the priestly. Here, Thirumeni goes back to the basic understanding of diakonia. That means the centrality of the cultic or the priestly, which the Western enlightened rational mind consider only as the peripheral. He says, It is most tragic thing about modern rationality that it has lost all sensibility to ritual and worship, wherein truths much deeper than the discursive are signified. There he beautifully explains the significance of Eucharist. In the Eucharistic act, we offer ourselves to God and be united with Christ in his salvific sacrifice. Let me quote again his words. The whole church participating in Christ's priesthood offer itself on behalf of the world, not just on behalf of itself. Through baptism, all Christians are united into this Christic high priesthood. Therefore, like Christ the high priest, the church should become a source spring of blessing and love for all. The second aspect of the ministry is the prophetic ministry. This ministry should be both addressed to the church and the outside world. In the Pauline writings, the prophetic ministry is for the building up of the church. According to St. Paul, church is built upon the foundation of apostles and prophets, Ephesians 2:20. Tirumeni strongly suggests this ministry of the building up of the church need to get special attention if the ministry of the church is to be renewed today. He reminds us that the Christian church forgets the vicarious nature of its call. The third aspect of the ministry of the King Shepherd. In the Old Testament, Yahweh promised through the prophets to the people of Israel a new messianic king. Ezekiel 34:23 says, I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall free them and be their shepherd. It is also important to note that this promise was made when the shepherds of Israel, that is their kings, their prophets, the priests and the leaders who were supposed to take care of the people of Israel, were feeding themselves. If you read chapter 34 of Ezekiel, you will understand this more. But they were feeding themselves instead of feeding the sheep. And the sheep were scattered with no one to search or to care for them. And this promised shepherd was fulfilled in Jesus the Messiah. This Old Testament passage is alluded to in the Gospels when Jesus is narrated as when Jesus saw a large crowd, he had compassion for them because they were like sheep without shepherd. We will discuss this again in the question answer session. It is interesting to note that in the New Testament, Jesus is addressed by many in different titles, like teacher, prophet, Lord, etc. But the titles which Jesus preferred to call himself are the shepherd and the son of man. In this King Shepherd ministry, Tirumeni highlights the three qualities of a good shepherd, which is mentioned in St. John chapter 10. The first one, the shepherd knows his sheep intimately by name. Here again, Tirumeni criticizes the dominant character of the church in the past through its political dominance till the Middle Ages, that means till the 15th century, and the colonial mission expansion in the last centuries, and the financial dominance through its mission aid and institutions, which is a present reality. And also, when the church hates any group, whether it is on the basis of religion or ideologies, then the church loses its credential as a good shepherd. We have good examples recently happened in Kerala. For example, a Christian leader made a speech in which he mentioned about love jihad and narcotic jihad, which was a controversy in Kerala. The second quality of a good shepherd, King Shepherd, is that to lead to good pastures. The shepherd will lead the sheep to good pastures. This quality is self-explanatory, so I'll go to the third one. The third is to lay down the life for the sheep. Here, Tirumeni is urging us to take bold step against the oppressive structures in the society. A fine example for this is Paulus Margirios Tirumeni himself. In the WCC Canberra Assembly, maybe some of you know about this incident. In the Canberra Assembly of WCC, Tirumeni was asked to speak in response to the speech of the Australian Prime Minister. In his response, Tirumeni vehemently criticized the Australian government's policies against the Aboriginals or the native people of Australia. Father Kame George, who was present in this assembly, was telling us the other day, around 3,000 people were present in the auditorium, gave a standing ovation to Tirumeni, but the white people who were present in the meeting was deeply offended. because the one who criticized a white prime minister is a brown-skinned Asian bishop. And Thirumeni had to pay the price afterwards for his outspokenness. He not only taught, he walked the talk. So let me conclude. The diaconia expected from the church is a dialectic diaconia of service of God and service of the fellow beings. In this service, the church's call is to participate in the priestly ministry of Jesus by offering itself on behalf of the world. Our call is to participate also in the prophetic and shepherd ministry of Jesus to lead his sheep from injustice to justice, oppression to freedom, hunger to satisfaction, darkness to light, and so on. But at the same time, following the footsteps of the good and the genuine shepherd, we should be ready to leave our comfort zones, even up to the point of laying our lives for the sheep. May the Holy Spirit guide us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Acha, for that short and sweet, and for explaining the article so well for us, so that all of us could understand the difficult words which were there in the article. I just want to add that now the floor is open for our panelists to put up the questions to Achin. And for more clarity, these questions have already been sent by the panelists to Achin beforehand. For better, more transparency, we'll just be mentioning that. And let's start with our first panelists. We have Ms. Rini Vergis putting up her question.
Good evening, Acha.
Good evening.
So, my question is, in what all aspect we say that church is fulfilling the purpose of Christ's teaching in this 21st century? Am I audible?
Yes, I heard it. In what all aspects can we say that the church is fulfilling the purpose of Christ's teaching in this 21st century?
Yes, Acha.
We can't say certainly that this all this aspect aspects of the ministry of Jesus is fulfilled by the church. That's not possible, because the church from the beginning itself, it has tried for the fulfilling of the teaching of our Lord. So if we quote the words of Paul to the Philippians about his ministry, not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Let me explain it. Paul is using one word, I take hold of. So he's using that word in two different tenses. In the first one, he says, the Christ has took hold of him. So he is a part of Christ. Christ has seized him. Once he said, Christ has seized me and Christ has made me his own. So he is a part of Christ, but the same word he uses again, take hold of, he says, he used that in the subjunctive. Subjunctive means that is a wish. He says that I press on to take hold of that call. So Christ has taken me, but now I'm trying to fulfill that call which Christ has called me. So that is his wish. So he is always striving towards that. So that's what Paul says in Corinthians also. We are moving forward from one step to the other. We are moving forward from glory to glory. 2 Corinthians 3:18. So that is always the church is, there will be mistakes from the part of the church. It's not perfect, but the church is moving towards perfection. So that is our call, to move towards that perfection. So we cannot say that which all aspects have been fulfilled. No, sometimes it is fulfilled, sometimes it is not. But we are striving towards that.
Thank you, Acha. And you're absolutely right. There can be imperfections. We're all human beings at the end of the day. So thank you, Rini, for your question. And I would also like to add on at this moment that for the viewers who are watching through YouTube, you can use the live chat box to put forth your questions. Through the live chat box, we've received a question, Acha. So I think we have Mr. Alex George, who's asking the question, why is there so much suffering in this world? It is said that as a Christian, we are meant to face sufferings and tribulations. Did God create mankind to suffer?
You might have heard the famous philosopher René Descartes. I think, therefore I am. René Descartes said, I think, therefore I am. You might have also heard what Thirumeni said. Thirumeni once said, I suffer, therefore I am. So suffering is something which makes us perfect. It doesn't mean that God is giving us some suffering, but when we try to fulfill the teachings of Jesus Christ, when we try to grow towards Christ, towards that image of Christ, of course there will be suffering. So that is not something which God has forcefully given or forcefully thrust upon us, but it's something which Paul always said, that is, I am privileged to suffer. That's the word Paul uses. That's a privilege. Suffering is a privilege. So you cannot consider it as a curse, but it's a privilege. Because through suffering, Paul says, I'm fulfilling, I'm joining the Christ's suffering, the sufferings of Christ. So suffering is always something very much Christian, which makes you perfect.
Thank you so much, Acha, for that answer. And I hope, Mr. Alex, it answers your question. Up next, we have another question from our panelist, Mr. Abel John Panikar. Over to you, Abel.
Good evening, Acha. Good evening, Seba.
Good evening.
My question is that in the chapter Christ Missionary to the World, the gates of Hades symbolizes the kingdom of sin and death. So how does the key to the gates of Hades have the power to forgive sins and give life?
I didn't understand. Please, once more, please.
In the chapter Christ Missionary. The gates of Hades symbolizes the kingdom of sin and death. So how does the key to the gates of Hades have the power to forgive sins and give life? This is from page 10. So
yeah, I have read that the power to forgive sin and the power for life is that power is given by Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ himself is the life. Jesus Christ himself has overcome death and defeated sin. So he himself is giving this power to the apostles. So by being a member of the body of Christ, by being an apostle of Christ, you are representing Christ. So that's why the apostles are given the power to forgive sins and to give life. So they are not doing in their own power, but in the power of the power that is given to them by Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ himself is the source of life. Jesus Christ himself has overcome death. So death was defeated on the cross. So this power was given to the apostles by Jesus Christ. So it is not they themselves are doing it, but they are doing it in the name of Jesus Christ.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Acha, for that well-answered question. Up next, we have Ms. Ginny Jacob putting up her question. Over to you, Ginny.
Good evening, Acha.
Good evening.
Acha, so my question is, why this mess has been created? Whose dominance have influenced the world that they no longer trust church nor respond to their voice? Am I audible, Acha?
Yes. I told you these biblical meditations were delivered at the WCC meetings. So WCC meeting, you know that the members of different churches will be present, and mostly Western churches or the West dominated churches, Reformed churches, are members of this WCC. So Thirumeni, while addressing this audience, in his mind, he is referring to the political dominance which the church had during the Middle Ages. That means from the 5th to the, or from the 4th to the 15th century. The church was very much involved in the politics of Europe, in the European politics. And after that, the evangelization, along with the colonial empires, which started in the 15th century, from 15th century onwards. So that also did not give a good impression of the church to the rest of the world. And later on, now the empire created by the institutions of the church. Therefore, many a time, people doubt the intentions of the church. So they themselves see a gulf between what we preach and what we do. So that's why Thirumeni is saying we ourselves, because of our dominant character, we have the people, the world do not trust us. Many of the people do not trust us. It is only because of the past things which the church has, the wrong things the church has done. So that is the reason. Because you know that the reason for the French Revolution, the reason for the Reformation, when Karl Marx wrote the Das Kapital, he was completely against, deadly against the church, only because of the then situation of the church. Because church was very much involved in the politics. The church was very much involved in the even in the intellectual world, and the church was trying to control everything. So the church gave a very bad image in the history. So that's why he said, people don't trust us. So we have to get back this trust. That is very much important. That's why he said, to be intimate with the sheep, you have to get back that trust which we have lost.
Thank you so much, Ginny, for that question. And thank you, Acha, for answering the question. Now, since we are done with our panelists, our floor is open to the participants who are here to ask some questions. So whoever wants to ask a question can raise their hands. Any questions? I think our host, Reverend Father Chirin Joseph, has a question.
Yes.
Sir, good evening. I'm sorry that I couldn't join earlier. I had some emergency here.
Good evening,
Good evening, Achan. So, Achan, just a question which I always think about, you know, when I come and when I meet the youngsters, especially because we all are the MGOC, some members of the diocese, the concept of suffering servant, like in this 21st century, if I see myself as a youngster, how can I change my thought? Because most of the time, our youngsters wants us to be successful. Success, which has its own meaning. Everyone wants to be successful. But if we look at the Bible and if we read about Jesus Christ, you know, in the modern terms, people may think that he was a failure in modern terms and worldly thoughts. But I think it is the church's duty, especially our duty, to explain to the youngsters that how I can be a suffering servant in this age also. Because it talks, Thirumeni, in his second page, this article, second page, he says about Mahatma Gandhi. Mm-hmm. You know, that he could see that Mahatma Gandhi as a suffering servant in another variant. So how can an youngster be adjusted to this thought while living in 21st century in the midst of all kinds of social applications, social media, wherein they have their own, they can practice their rights, they can practice the freedom of expression. But again, when somebody wants to live as a perfect Christian, this idea should be there in that person's mind. How can this, these youngsters inculcate that thought of suffering servant, you know, within themselves as a Christian through the liturgies, through our spiritual nourishment that we are going to, that we are giving to them?
First of all, Acha, almost the same situation was in the Church of Corinth. You know, when you studied the letter to the Corinthians, you might have learned this. Corinth community, or Corinth, was a place of excellence. Corinth was a place of Greek culture and Greek philosophy. So many of the people, many of the believers in the Corinthian church, they were actually from a Hellenistic background. They were well versed in Greek philosophy. So that's why in the letter to the Corinthians, Paul says that the wisdom of this world is foolishness for Christ, because those who are wise, or wise in the worldly sense, they think that Christ has done something foolish, because why did he died on a cross? So something foolish for them. But he says, for to those who are saved, this foolishness is wisdom. This is something difficult to understand, because the other one is the wisdom in the real sense. That means that we get from the world, get from our studies, from with our intellect, with our reasoning, we acquire wisdom, we get wisdom. And those who have that wisdom, they won't understand what is the wisdom in dying on a cross. So Paul says, Jesus himself is the wisdom. And Jesus himself is the wisdom of Christ. So if you want to understand that wisdom, you have to be in Christ. So once you are in Christ, then you are suffering not for the things that you have done. You are suffering, you are taking up the suffering of others, and you are suffering for them, on behalf of them. That's what the priestly ministry of Jesus. The priestly ministry of Jesus means taking up all. That's what Paul says. The whole creation is suffering. The whole creation is groaning for salvation. And it is the duty of the human beings, us believers, to bring this nature, the whole creation, along with us to the goal of salvation. So we are not suffering not because of something that we have done. Maybe something, sometimes that also may happen in our lives. Some suffering may come in our life. But why, if we are suffering for others? That's what Jesus says. If you are a true shepherd, you are ready to give your life for others. Nothing, you are taking that responsibility on yourself. You are taking that responsibility. That's why very much emphasize the fact that you are called as a priestly kingdom. A priestly kingdom means a priest is an individual. Kingdom is something which is corporate. He never said a priestly king. He said a priestly kingdom. You are a priest, then you are an individual. But you are not just an individual, but you are part of a kingdom. So you are part of a body. So when my neighbor suffers, so when my friend suffers, that is my suffering. So I take it up as my suffering. So I am coming before God with this priestly character, taking up the suffering of my friend, taking up the suffering of my fellow beings, and offering myself to God. So that is what we are called for. So that is what really the meaning of Ebed Yahweh. Ebed means, you know that, the servant of God. Servant of God, Jesus was called the servant of God only because of this priestly ministry of Jesus. That is why when you read the book of Revelation, John was called up to heaven and the angel comes with the scroll, and John and the angel is looking for somebody to open this scroll, and there was a voice from the heaven, and it says the king of Judah will open it. He is the only one worthy to open it. And John is looking for the king of Judah, and what he sees, a lamb who is a wounded lamb, a lamb who is bruised, who has wound all over his body. That is the king. That wounded lamb is the one who is worthy to open the scroll. So the king, according to the angel, the voice from the heaven said, the king of Judah will open. But that was the king of Judah was a wounded lamb. So Jesus became king through his death on the cross. So Jesus never conquered death. Jesus never conquered by having a fight with someone. Jesus conquered by giving himself. Jesus conquered death by giving his life. So that is the difference between the kingship of Jesus and the king which the people of Israel was expecting. So this kingship of Jesus, that is why in the Gospels, Jesus never took up the name king. It's somebody asked him, it's Pilate who asked him, are you the king? Then Jesus gives him a very vague answer. He said, you say so. Jesus never said, yes, I am the king. He never said. He said, you say so. So that is very ambiguous, because if Jesus say that I am the king, they won't understand it. A king who is going to be killed, they will never understand. So that kind of priestly king is something which is the suffering servant. So this, to understand this, you have to be in Christ and you have to know what Christ's mission was. Then you will understand it. So that wisdom and this wisdom is something different. So to comprehend that, if I use the words of Paul, you have to have the same mind of Christ. You have to have the same mind of Christ. That's the word used is nous. Nous means you have to think along with Christ. It is the Holy Spirit. It is the inner eye. The inner eye has to be opened. So that is not the wisdom which we get from the books. It is not the wisdom from the universities. It is a wisdom from the nous, from the inner eye. So that is what we have to look forward for. Thank you.
Thank you, Achin, for this wonderful explanation. So if we put everything in a nutshell, if I say that our youngsters must, through Dr. Paulos Mark Gregorius, who has enlightened us through his articles, how to follow Christ and be Christ-like, how to be in Christ, even in this modern day, because as youngsters, the MGOCSM members, as youngsters, whatever we do, we should do everything in Christ. I mean, that's what I personally suggest every listener, to follow Christ, as like Achin said about the New Testament, the city of Corinth, and how Christ is not known as the king, but as a servant of God. Thank you, Achin. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chirin Acha. Thank you, Joji Acha. I have one more question for you, Acha. Let me just put it this way. When we talk about the societal aspect, suffering is usually seen as punishment. How can we relate this to this article, and how do we analyze which suffering is positive and which one is a negative suffering? So like punishment and a positive suffering, how do we make a distinction between that? Because human beings tendency to run away from pain. They seek pleasure. So,
Seeking pleasure is a different thing. But to analyze what kind of suffering is what, that is a bit difficult thing. Because I personally always believe, and many of my teachers have told me, God is not someone who punishes us. Of course, in the Old Testament, There are instances in which God has punished the people. But in the when we come to the New Testament, especially in the Gospel of John, you might have read about it. Especially in the Gospel of John, Jesus says about judgment. Light has come into the world, and those who does not recognize the light is already judged. And he says, God the Father says, I am not the one who is to judge. It is the Son who is going to judge. Jesus the Son says, I am not going to judge because the light has come into the world. That itself is a judgment. So the New Testament God, which is revealed to us, is a God who is reluctant to judgment, reluctant to punish. So we cannot say it because God so loved the world that he gave his Son to the world. So that a God who has so much loved the world, how can he judge us? How can he punish us? This is something which is difficult to answer. I don't think that, personally, I believe a God who loves, he cannot punish us. It is something which our choice, whether we choose the light. Light means Jesus Christ. If you choose the light, then your works will be the works of light. If you choose darkness, your work will be the works of darkness, and that will eventually lead you to judgment and punishment. That's your problem. So I don't want to believe in a God who punishes.
Absolutely true, Acha. Thank you so much. We have lots of questions on YouTube also, so I'll try to put up a few. Ekos from Imjism Ghaziabad is asking that is suffering of prophet Job diakonia, or tribulations are as test of God is not diakonia?
No, diakonia has nothing to do with this tribulations. Diakonia means a service. Diakonia has two meanings. I told diakonia is either the service to the human beings or the avoda Yahweh, or the worship of God. So it is through the worship of God you will be equipped to Tirmini in the first or second meditation. He says Moses went up to the Mount Sinai, and when he came down, his face was shining. So he says this face shining experience is necessary. That means the avoda Yahweh, that means the worship of Yahweh, which makes your face shining. That face shining experience is necessary for the second avoda, that means the diakonia to the fellow human beings. That means once you have entered into the presence of God and your face is shining, you are really equipped to face the people. So to do the service for your fellow human beings. So that is what is diakonia mean. That has nothing to do with suffering. This suffering is something which is related to the ministry, the shepherd ministry or the priestly ministry of Jesus Christ. So that's a different thing.
Okay, Acha, thank you so much. Next question is, everyone is a sinner. So how can we experience a holy God if we are unholy? Question by Alina.
You can't say that everyone is a sinner. Of course, we are sinners. It doesn't mean that we are alienated from God. We are actually, once you are united to the body of Christ, again, I come back to the letters of Paul. Paul says in Ephesians, in the letter to the Ephesians, I think, in that Paul says, once you are united to Christ, you will become citizens of the heavenly Jerusalem. So that means socially you are in. Second, he says, then you will become a member of the household of God. A member of the household of God means in that house, Jesus is the Son and you are his brothers or sisters. So you are becoming one family with Christ. So and you have the right like Jesus, to call him Abba or Father. So you are entering into a very intimate relationship with God once you are in Christ. So, of course, we are sinners. Of course, we are sinners. That doesn't mean that we are alienated from God. We are a member of the household of God. So we can experience that intimate relationship with God. So that is what we have to think positively about. So earlier, which I have, the word which I have used, you have to strive for that. You have to strive to that goal of salvation. Like St. Paul said, you have to strive forward. We are always moving from one step to the other, from glory to glory, to the same image of Christ. So when we say that we are all sinners, that is an Augustinian way of saying. Augustine always said, man is a massa damnata. That means a man is a mass of flesh that is doomed, that cannot be saved. It is only by grace God will allow us to be saved. It is not like that. We are all creation of God. We are all members of while we are the members of the body of Christ, we are in Christ. We are members of the household of Christ.
Thank you, Acha. Now, I would like to ask one question from my side. So in the recent times, we don't easily find many good Samaritans who do service unconditionally. Everyone usually tries to turn their back to people who are suffering. So how do we try to instill some kind of empathy or something in our youngsters so we care more and can be of more service to others? How do we do that?
Of course, there are many good Samaritans. The problem is good Samaritans are not visible. Good Samaritans will not say that I'm a good Samaritan, and they won't come in the media. So the only thing we can do by saying or teaching, you cannot make anybody a good Samaritan. It's only through, we have to be a model for others. We all have to follow the footsteps of Christ. We all have to be good Samaritans. Then the others will join us. You cannot teach anybody to be a good Samaritan. So that's what Jesus said there. Who is your neighbor? So Jesus purposefully took the name of a Samaritan, because Samaritan was an enemy of a Jew. Always the Jewish religion was always opposed to the Samaritan religion. So Jesus said even an enemy could become a good Samaritan, a good person. So you always expect that there are good Samaritans around us. And you yourself, we ourselves should become a model for others. You cannot teach anybody to be Christ-like. You can only show them what is Christ-like to be.
Thank you, Acha. Now that I think that was the last question. Now, before we wind up, any final comments, Acha, that you want to give after listening to all these questions from our youngsters? Any final message or comment that you want to give to our viewers and our youngsters?
First of all, for me, I'm very honored. I'm very happy to be a part of this study series, so that I could also learn something about Paulus Mar Gregorius. The challenge which Thirumeni has put before us is how you are going to be a good Christian in a multi-religious society. So Thirumeni, even those who are in Delhi, you know that the Delhi Diocese Center was called Sarva Dharma Nilaya. So that was a very, very challenging thing, that name that he has given to that Orthodox center. A Christian bishop giving such a name to an Orthodox center, something very revolutionary during that period. So Thirumeni was at ease with people of different religions. I have heard from K.M. Jorajachan that Dalai Lama, during his early times, Dalai Lama was having some difficulty in speaking in English. So when somebody asked him some question about the Buddhist religion or something related to the Buddhist religion, Dalai Lama used to say to the questioner, now my friend Paulus Mar Gregorius will answer it. See the confidence that Thirumeni has given to a leader of another religion. So this is something which is very important in this new political situation of India. To take people from other religions into confidence, to make them understand that we are not here as somebody to convert them, we are not here to overpower them. We are here to live along with them as normal human beings. So that's why Thirumeni always thought of a new humanity in which everybody can live together. So that is the message I think Thirumeni wanted to convey to all of us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Acha. And that's a very beautiful thought. I hope we all can work towards achieving this new humanity that you've mentioned, working together. And I really thank you for being so patient with us and answering all the questions that you sent through your way. And we love reading these articles. We love asking questions to all our resource persons. And we are thankful to you and to all the panelists and the viewers who've been putting up questions in YouTube as well, to make this discussion really active and to also take this article and like really throw light in it and make this a successful episode. So I hope all the viewers, you enjoyed watching this wonderful session. And I also urge you to send more suggestions in the comment box for future articles. And I thank all of you for watching this episode. And I hope all of you have a blessed night. Thank you so much, everyone.